Okay, let's continue. Thank you all for coming. I see many new faces from the first afternoon lecture. I won't introduce Michael Heinrich extensively. Most of you have probably heard of him already. He teaches economics in Berlin. He is very influential in Germany and increasingly internationally, a very influential representative of value form theory, or Neumarx-Lektüre, as we prefer. And he will now give us a lecture on the very very complex and very controversial issue of the theory of the state, the bourgeois Marxist theories, or well, Marxian Marxist. We will see the difference in the course of the presentation, I assume. The theories of the state. But before we do that, I want to say that this year's focus of most of our activities as a center for labor studies will be precisely state theory. So this is also for this year the first lecture on the subject. And before we start, one more reminder, as always, we need you to please sign in this list of participants. As you know, we need this to show to our funders. And for those of you who have been already at the afternoon session, this is a new list, so please enter your name in this one as well. So thank you very much, and now Michael.
Yeah, thank you very much for the invitation again, now in the holy rooms of university, to talk about Marx. I stress Marx and not Marxist theory of state. Here I think it is really important to stress the difference. As you probably know, from Marx, it is given this famous sentence, je ne suis pas marxiste, I am not a Marxist, when he heard from his son of law, Paul Lafargue, what French Marxists did. So I think we really have to distinguish between Marx theories and the tradition of Marxist thinking, of trying to complete such theories, to extend such theories. And this plays an important role in state theory, because Marx never wrote a book about the state. He wrote a book, Capital, about capitalist economy, but never about the state. He planned to do this, but he didn't find the time and the possibilities to execute this. Nevertheless, there are a lot of remarks about state, class, the ruling class, politics, and so on. And there are some concrete political analyses, and last not least, there is the economic analysis, which in some respect provides us with a basis for state theory considerations. But when we want to learn about Marx's theory of the state, it is not enough just to put this together like elements of a puzzle, where each element has nearly the same importance. We have to consider that Marx himself did a development. His early writings express different focuses, different central issues compared with writings of his middle age and his later writings. For example, in Communist Manifesto, besides capital, the most known and most read text, we find a very short characterization of a bourgeois state that he writes, it is a committee of the ruling class. And from this, many Marxists and also many critics of Marx derived that for Marx, the state is just a tool for the ruling class. The ruling class uses the state to take benefit. The state just translates the interests of the ruling class in practical policy. Nevertheless, it is not so easy to say what are the interests of the ruling class, because the ruling class in capitalist society is the capitalist class, and the capitalist class consists of a lot of fractions with opposed, with interests which are opposed to each other. So such a formulation that the state just executes the interests of the ruling class is not an answer, it is more a question. What are the interests of the ruling class, how these interests can be found, and how they can be translated in state policy. So we have really to be careful and not to stick to such isolated sentences, like the quoted sentence from the Communist Manifesto. Also, in some respect, we must be cautious with the concrete analysis we find in the oeuvre of Marx. Very famous, and correctly very famous, is the 18th Brumaire. It is this analysis about the coup d'etat of Napoleon III, a very detailed, very brilliant analysis, which at least makes clear it is not so easy with the ruling class. There are so many fractions. There is also a kind of self-dynamic of policy that such simple formulas of the state as a committee of the ruling class cannot tell anything. And then there is another concrete analysis written nearly 20 years later than the 18th Brumaire. It is the Civil War in France. It is this book where Marx analyzes the Paris Commune, which took place during the German-French War in the years 1770-71. And here we find not only elements of an analysis of the state, but also an analysis or elements of an analysis of opposing the state, of creating new forms. I don't want to say of rule, but of organization, to abolish bourgeois rule, but nevertheless there stays the problem of organizing life in society. And Marx considered the Paris Commune as the first example or the first attempt to come to a non-capitalist organization of the social life since we had capitalism. So we have all these elements and also some more elements I don't have the time to mention here, but we have to be very cautious in putting some elements of a state theory together. In which respect we have to be cautious We find also a hint in the writings of Marx himself, in this famous preface of 1859 to a contribution to the Critique of Political Economy. Marx writes that the political forms of states, of policy, are rooted in the anatomy of the bourgeois society, and the basis here is political economy. When this is true, that basically the forms of state and policy are rooted in the political economy, this means that the analysis of state and policy depends from the understanding of political economy of the person who is doing the analysis. And here it is important that for Marx, from the early 1850s, when he was forced to go to exile in London, a new phase, a new period of analysis of political economy starts. His Critique of Political Economy really starts with the so-called London Notebooks, which emerged in the early 1850s, then led to Grundrisse, theories of surplus value, capital, and so on. And when we try then to combine the elements of his political thinking, we always have to have in mind how far he was in his analysis of political economy, how far the Critique of Political Economy was developed. And this is a little bit for me now in my presentation, the guideline. These are these remarks until now was the necessary introduction to what comes now. It is the guideline, this economic analysis, what we have to choose from this political analysis. So I will not present you considerations about the state according to some of the mentioned works of Marx, but I will make the attempt to give you at least three directions of analysis which follow from the developed Critique of Political Economy using some of these elements of political analysis we can find in Marx. Marx stresses very much the difference between capitalist and pre-capitalist societies. In this afternoon lecture, I already spoke about value and in connection with this, about the difference between personal and impersonal rule. This is, in this respect, a very important difference. And exactly this, it was my last point in the afternoon, we can use as a starting point for Marx's analysis of the state. Pre-capitalist societies are characterized by personal rule. I used the example of slave and master in the afternoon. Bourgeois society is characterized by free and equal citizens, legal free and equal citizens, so that bourgeois thinkers use this often as an argument to say we don't have any rule in bourgeois society. Economically, we have an impersonal rule. The economic logic demands from the persons a certain behavior, even if there is not a person who is forcing them. The logic of economy is the forcing power. But for the state, this existence of a free and equal citizen has a different consequence. When the citizens are free and equal, then the state, with its power, with its power machine, must be a neutral one. It cannot be the machine only of one part of the population or of one class. If this would happen, then obviously the citizens couldn't be in the same way equal. So the neutrality of the state is a direct consequence of this status of free and equal citizens. But when the state is neutral, then at once the question emerges, can we then speak of class rule? Free citizens, a neutral state, is it how this fits together with a ruling class and similar concepts? A lot of Marxists therefore try to show that the neutrality of the state is a pure fiction, that the state makes a policy in favor of the capitalist class, and of course you can find a lot of examples that some enterprises, some important capitalists have big influence in, they influence political processes, they influence even the process of producing a law. But this also is a scandal in bourgeois public. So that the state is one-sided is not really a left critic. It is a bourgeois critic, and it is very clear why it is a bourgeois critic. When the state favors one fraction of capital, then this is a disadvantage for other fractions of capital, and of course they feel damaged and they try to prevent their interests by scandalizing the bias of the state. So the neutrality of the state, although it is hurted, it is violated so often, it is also a reality. And it is not only a reality, it is in some respect a necessity for a proper functioning of a bourgeois state. But nevertheless, this neutrality doesn't exclude the class rule. It just confirms, it is just the proper method to execute this class rule. And this is very well known even in the times before Marx. Marx in his early writings quotes a French author who a little bit ironically wrote, "The state forbids equally to the rich men and to the poor men to sleep under the bridge." So the state totally respects the equality of the citizens. The law counts for everybody. Everybody who hurts the law is chased, is accused. But of course, this equal law has very different consequences for persons who are materially very unequal. The rich man doesn't need to sleep under the bridge. The poor man maybe needs this. So when the bourgeois state, as a legal state, a state of law, guarantees property, guarantees or secures that treaties may not be violated. Pacta sunt servanda, says an old rule of Roman law already. When the state guarantees this for everybody, the state automatically is in favor of the capitalist class, because the capitalist class has the big property of company, of means of productions, of companies, of machines, and so on. The mass of the population has only very small private property. When the state guarantees each form of property, then of course the state guarantees the superiority of the capitalist class. So, the neutrality of the state, the form of the state as a legal state, is not a fiction. In the contrary, it is necessary for a smooth functioning of a capitalist economy. When this neutrality is violated, also the capitalist process is violated. Another aspect in state discussions, in discussions about state, refers just to the opposite of this neutrality, that the state, as a welfare state, makes some choices. The state, as a welfare state, in some respect, supports the poorer part of the population. We have a kind of social welfare for the most poorest part of the people. We have in many states things like an unemployment insurance, so when you are unemployed, you get some support. We have health insurance, we have pension, a state pension fund, and so on. Here, when we analyze this, we find sometimes a little bit strange coalition in interpretation, not in behavior, in action, but in understanding, between conservatives who say, oh, this welfare state is the first step to socialism. We have to abolish welfare state, or we have to diminish welfare state. A real liberal society needs free markets, but not a welfare state with welfare bureaucracy, which will hinder free markets. And on the other hand, you can find a lot of leftists, which or who in some respect argue in a similar way, like such conservatives. They argue the welfare state is the result of the fights of the working class. The working class against the capitalist class, against the state who was in favor of capitalist class, managed to reach such welfare institutions. So they are our institutions against the capitalist class. This, in some respect, is exactly the same what the conservatives say. The only difference is that the conservatives come to a negative judgment. They say, oh, this is a very bad tendency. The leftists see this in a positive way. We gain land from the capitalists. Here, I think a central point is missed. The welfare state, of course, makes life for the simple worker easier. It is easier when I'm unemployed that I get support from the state than I don't get support. But by no means this is an anti-capitalist measure. What is the capitalist function, for example, of an unemployment insurance or a health insurance? It keeps the labor force disposable for capital. The labor force, when we have a time of unemployment, what does this mean? That we have more labor force than it is necessary for the aim of valorization, of profit making for the capital. But that we have now too much labor force doesn't mean that we have too much labor force for all the time. In the next, when in the conjunctural cycle, we have an uprising time for capital. Capital will grow fastly, will grow quickly, and will need more labor time. With unemployment insurance, health insurance, the labor force is preserved for capital. It is not, it will not vanish in developed welfare states like we have it's still in Germany. The unemployed labor force is forced to do some qualification, to be educated, so that later it has a bigger use for capital. The labor force who is sick, it can become healthy and again can be exploited by capital. So such institutions of the welfare state, they help the individual worker, no question, but this is not against the interests of capital. It also serves the interest of capital. And this is even the case when we look to state-run pension funds. Of course, the old labor force who will receive the pension, it is not preserved for capital. But when your pension is depending on your lifelong work, then this is a big power that you yourself are interested always to be a wage laborer, that you become a very disciplined worker, that when there is a danger to lose your job, that you know very well it is not only my present income, which to some extent will be substituted by the unemployment support. No, it is a big damage also for the income which I will have in my old age. And in Germany, this provoked, for example, the situation that even persons in the age of 25 think, oh, what will be my pension? They don't think of the next 5 years in capitalism, they think what will be in 50 years in my life in capitalism. And so this pension fund has a very inclusive function. It binds people a lot to the capitalist system. So the welfare state by no means is anti-capitalistic. Also, when we think of crisis, another aspect is very important. The welfare state is a tool, in some respect, working against crisis, making crisis more soft. In the mid of 19th century, when there was nearly no welfare state, when we had an economic crisis with a big rise of unemployment, this means that the mass incomes diminished very quickly, the mass demand diminished, and this sharpened the crisis. Now, with the welfare state, we have something what is called, also in mainstream economics, the automatic stabilization process, that we have in a crisis process a rise of the rate of unemployment, but because of the financial support of the unemployment persons, we have not such a big diminishing of the mass incomes, and we have not such a quick fall in mass demand. And this softens the crisis very much. It can, of course, not prevent a crisis, but the shape of the crisis is changed a lot by such mechanisms. So, when we now look on this welfare state from a little bit more general perspective, we can discover something what Friedrich Engels, for what Friedrich Engels coined a very nice expression. He spoke of the capitalist state as the ideal collective or total capitalist. The state is not real a single capitalist with some single interests. It is a kind of the total capitalist in an ideal way, not in a real way, in an ideal way. What does this mean? The state serves the capitalist interests, but not the interests of a single capital group or a single fraction of capital. The state serves the interests of the capitalist system as a whole. And especially the welfare state is an example in which way the bourgeois state is doing this job. In Capital, in the book Capital by Marx, we can also already find the starting point of such an analysis when Marx in chapter 8 of volume 1 analyzes the limits of the working day and the legal limits imposed by the state. Why the state imposed such limits to the working day, which were also limits to exploitation by capital, they were imposed in order to secure the exploitation in the long run. In this early capitalism, in early 19th century in Great Britain, the working time was extended so enormously that the people were physically destroyed. The English state recognized this when he tried to get soldiers for its big system of colonies, and already the 18, 19 year old persons who should become soldiers were physically so destroyed because they had to start in the industry to work with 6, 7, or 8 years age, that with 18 years they couldn't be used as soldiers. So it was clear for the state there is a problem, but this was not only a state problem, it was also an economic problem, and the state imposed limits to exploitation which were against the actual interests of capitalists in order to secure the long-lasting possibility of exploitation and capitalist rule, capitalist economic system. This holds also for other parts of the state activities. For example, that the state provides capitalist economy with infrastructure in different fields. Infrastructure, for example, providing streets or trains, mobility for the economy, or also providing schools, university to produce qualified persons for capital. All this is in some respect necessary for the smooth functioning of a capitalist economy. But it has also a backside. The welfare state needs money. The infrastructure project need money. So these state activities have costs. And when we have costs, then at once there is a discussion or even a battle about these costs. Can we reduce them? Who has to bear the biggest share of these costs, and so on. Therefore, the welfare state always is disputed. Always you have some experts, some capital fractions who try to diminish the welfare state. On the other hand, you have, for example, trade unions who try to extend welfare states. These are usual disputes, usual conflicts inside the capitalist society, inside a bourgeois system of state. It is not the first step in order to abolish capitalism or in order to abolish the bourgeois state. It's a totally immanent conflict to this system. And here I come to the third point after my first point. It was the legal state and neutrality. The second point was welfare state and state providing infrastructure. The third point, which belongs to such Marxian state theory, is the question of democracy and public discussion. Here, very often, we have a debate that leftists criticize the democratic forms of the bourgeois state, demand real democracy, finally real democracy, because democracy in bourgeois state is so limited, and the one. Conservatives often speak of too much democracy. They insist on a strong state which has to find quickly decisions, and we have too much obstacles for quick decisions, and so on. So there is a question: what is the relation between democracy and capitalism? Some authors argue there is a contradiction. There is either democracy or capitalism, or maybe in a weaker form, they argue the stronger the democracy, the weaker capitalism, and also the other way around. I don't share this opinion. I think democracy and capitalism fit very nicely together. Democracy is exactly the method or the way in which this neutral state, this necessarily neutral state, gets knowledge of such a thing like the capitalist class interests. As I stressed before, the capitalist class is consisted out of competing fractions. The capitalist class is a class which members always fight against each other. So there is the question, what is the common interest of this class which fights against itself? It needs mechanisms to find out these interests, mechanisms to create a balance between different interests. And historically, we can say the best, the most smooth method to do this job is really democracy, a parliament, which is elected in free elections and not in some controlled elections, and also a free press where different fractions can argue freely, is the best method to find out this capitalist class interest. But this is not the whole story of what the state here has to do. In capitalist society, we have subaltern classes. We have the working class, which is economically exploited. Maybe we have splits of some other classes also. And these subaltern classes must in some respect agree to their subaltern position. When the subaltern classes don't agree to this position, we have a very fierce social battle. The state has to react with a lot of oppression, and oppression alone has big difficulties to secure the rule, the domination, as we can see in a lot of dictatorial systems. And it is not at all very good for at least for a developed capitalist system. So in order to use only oppression, the state needs mechanisms, needs processes to include the subaltern classes, to produce a certain consensus with of the subaltern classes with their own subaltern positions. And again, free press, public sphere, and a democratic system is the very appropriate system to do this. Subaltern classes can articulate their interests, and they can come into this mechanism of balancing certain interests, of course, under the dominance of the capitalist rule. Not because the capitalists bribe the politicians or have too much influence, just because of the logic of the system. The workers, they want to have higher wages. Okay, what is the method to get higher wages? The capitalist companies need higher profits, then they can pay higher wages. Insofar, you can explain to the workers, you also have an interest that our economy is flourishing. And this is very abbreviated, very simplified in my presentation, but this is the logic according to which a lot of economic debate is working. In Germany, we have for this a very nice example. In the 1970s, the German Chancellor Helmut Schmidt, social democratic chancellor, also now well known, famous, I think also beyond the boundaries of Germany, was attacked by leftists that he, as a social democratic chancellor, provides policies in favor of capital. And he answered with a classical sentence. He said, "The profits of today are the investments of tomorrow and the working places of the day after tomorrow." The sentence is not totally correct. He should say, "The profits of today may perhaps lead to investments tomorrow, and they will eventually lead to more employment chances in the day after tomorrow." But basically, he was absolutely right. In a capitalist economy, profit is the center of the working of the economy. When there is too less profit, then this economic machine is not working, and this has damaging consequences also for the rest of the society. So when you are not against capitalism, that you don't see your task in fighting against capitalism, then no matter what you prefer personally, you have to support profits. And when then, under this presupposition, it is discussed how we can fulfill certain demands of the working class, certain demands of the freelancers, certain demands of the big companies, of the small companies, then we really reach the best in the sense of capitalist system. Not because someone is bribed or has too much influence, just because democracy and the discussions in the public sphere already presuppose the capitalist system as something which is taken for granted. And in this way, democracy and the public sphere is not against capitalism. It is really the most smooth way to fulfill the political tasks in a capitalist system. So when now critics ask for real democracy, when persons say, to vote each 4 years for a new parliament, and we cannot do more than this, this is too less, this is not real democracy, then I think I would give to such positions two answers. If you just want to reform some political institutions, that, for example, that you can vote not only for the parliament, that you want to have the possibility for a referendum about decisive points, of course you can demand this, and it is not unrealistic that such changes will come, because they are totally inside the bourgeois field of politics. But when you really want to have an alternative to capitalism, then the demand we want real democracy is much too less. By some persons, this real democracy is just a kind of code name for another society. But when you want really to have another society, you must also demand this, and you must attack and criticize the existing capitalist society. In so far, for such a fundamental critic, the demand for real democracy is not at all enough. The demand must be to criticize capitalism, to try to overcome capitalism. And then in a non-capitalist society, this is important, political conflicts will not vanish. To abolish capitalism will not bring a society without any conflicts. And for these conflicts, of course, one needs certain institutions, which we can say you need real democracy. But this is quite another cup of tea. To talk about political institutions to come to decisions, to discussions in a non-capitalist environment is totally different from discussing political institutions in a capitalist environment. And as long as we have a capitalist environment, the restriction of critique to political institutions is much, much too less. And in so far, I think when we have in mind this political conclusion, then also the maybe abstract considerations and theoretization of state theory becomes very practical, very political, politically important, and not only a kind of discussion for the academic sphere, but also a discussion for militants, for activists. So, thank you very much for your attention, and now we can come to the part of discussion.
Thank you, Michael. We have 15 good minutes of time to discuss, to ask questions or give comments. Do we have a volunteer?
Not me. If you were desperate, otherwise,
well, the other option, desperate option is myself.
Okay, so let's
start with that. Okay, then you.
Right. It's a truly desperate view of bourgeois state because
I didn't understand the first.
It's a truly depressive view of bourgeois state. I just wonder. I'm sure you're familiar with works of people like E.P. Thompson or Michael Lebowitz's view of the state. Does any of it resonate with you? For example, the argument, I mean, Bismarck in Germany is a good example. When they instituted the first elements in Germany I studied the history of the welfare state. When they instituted it was to please, of course, workers so that they don't look to the left, they don't vote for left parties, they don't join unions. So it was obviously a move against left being popular in their own ways at the time. But that was done based on history which is centuries old. Even in Greece, even in Roman times, you had burial society. But in UK, to Germany to extent, but I'm not so familiar with Germany, friendly society provided mutual help for centuries. Then they developed in proper mutual aid, which provided doctors for the first time, so that in 1948, when Nye Bevan instituted National Health Service in UK, he said, we will categorize the society, meaning we will provide health service for all according to needs, like the miners, socialist miners of Wales did for 50 years before. So, I mean, do you see any argument that there is a continuation of labor struggles that resulted in welfare state and that was captured, of course, to provide different political aims at different times? But I mean, I'm puzzled by this lack of history, basically, in your exposition of this topic.
Okay, you cannot, from an exposition of 50 minutes, so I don't know how long I talked, expect everything.
No, of course.
I did an introduction in which maybe I was not clear enough. I tried to explain that I will try to come to some considerations of the state of the level of abstraction given by the critique of political economy. I mentioned the historical writings of Marx, 18th Primaire and Civil War in France, but I stressed I will not use them to generalize something, but I will follow the hint of Marx that state institutions you can only understand with the background of political economy. So, in some respect, my scope in this lecture was, when you want to say, ahistorical. It tries to point out what we can say about the bourgeois state with the analysis of capital, the book Capital, in mind. The historical level is important, absolutely no question. But the point is, I gave the hint, but maybe it was too short, with the working day, that the function of a certain institution for the capitalist mode of production and the historical way how it emerged, how it was imposed, are just two different things. The limitation of the working day, for example, was an eminent, necessary act to secure that capitalist exploitation can survive. But how it was imposed, that on the one hand the state realized, oh, all these young men are not anymore, we cannot use them anymore as good soldiers because they are physically damaged. Then you had also a growing workers' movement who wanted to reduce labor time. So you had different forces and they brought a certain result. This is the historical process. But then we have to ask, does this result really fit together with the capitalist mode of production or does it not fit? And I can give arguments that it fits very well. But this question then is important for the understanding of the result. So the historical process to produce the result can follow a very different logic compared with the structural logic of this result. And okay, I stressed to this last point, because in some respect the historical logic can misleading. For example, it's completely true that the starting point of social reforms in Bismarck area in Germany was directed against social democracy. Social democracy, early trade unions provided the workers with certain services. Bismarck, a very clever guy, had the idea we have to provide them with this service. The demands are not irrational, they are well founded. So we as a good state, we fulfill these demands and by this social democracy will lose its supporters. This is absolutely true, but there is then a left tradition who sees welfare state either as a kind of ideological illusion to get the support of the workers, or either as the result of fights. But it is also a result of the outcome of capitalist logic. And this point I try to stress because I think it is totally underestimated in a lot of discussions.
Can I follow up and then other people can ask questions, because I wanted to ask to have a maybe similar intervention, but maybe one that may maybe or maybe not mediate between what Tony suggests and what you are saying. And this is something that I've been thinking about a lot, so I'm interested on your take on this. Well, much of what you have said, in the way you have said it, the usually what one hears then is something like, this is a strict functionalist model of the functioning of the state. History is completely eliminated, and if you say this is the best and smooth method, and therefore it exists, this is implied.
I didn't say therefore.
Okay, but this is what people hear. Okay, yeah. That's okay. Phrase it this way. Yeah. So there is a certain functionalist implication or a possibility of misreading. Mm. Okay. So maybe, so to go one step back theoretically, if we this whole approach on state theory, which is of course developed in the 70s in Germany as part of the tradition of the new readings of Marx and so on, one of its central points of origin was the so-called Pashukani's Frage, the Pashukani's question, which you have in some way paraphrased but not explicitly stated that this is it. So the question is basically, why does in a capitalist society, why doesn't class rule take the form of immediate class rule, like in feudalism or in slavery and so on? Why is it that the ruling class, the capitalists, are not identical with the political rulers? And I think that there are two ways of reading this. One is to read it, why does in capitalist societies the class rule of the ruling of the capitalists necessarily not take the form of immediate class rule, like necessarily? So yes, there has to be. The other way is of reading it would be, which I would suggest would maybe resolve some of these seeming contradictions, would be why is it that this is the only form of class rule which structurally allows for a certain margin of possibilities of variations. So it can even reproduce itself and function even without immediate class rule, even by giving certain political rights, even by giving, precisely because it is based on, as you said, when the state guarantees everyone's ownership. But what it effectively guarantees is the reproduction of class relations, because if you all you have, all your property is labor power, it only guarantees you that you will be reproduced as labor power, that you will be able to reproduce your labor power. So because it is a silent compulsion, a silent economic compulsion, which is basically what makes it impersonal, and which allows for it to take even forms or which are historically without precedent. But I wouldn't say that this necessarily leads that it has to take this fully developed form of, you know, like of a complete withdrawal from such pre-capitalist modes of domination, because that can be historically very easily refuted. That there have been capitalist societies and still are where it doesn't take this fully developed form in the, implied in the Pashukani's question. But then I would say so if we say that this is a form of society which allows for this structural margin of variations of, yes, of form, and this allows this absolute, seemingly absolute impersonal power, but then the function, the central criteria would be the functionality for it, for the profit, for capital. For the continued self reproduction of the capitalist mode of production, self valorization of value. And from that point, I think that would be my second point. I'm not so sure that you can say the welfare state is not anti-capitalist. I would say it is not necessarily anti-capitalist, but in its objective implications, everything that threatens the reproduction of capital, that threatens profit, the profit motive, is a danger to the reproduction of capitalism. But this then only means that capitalism will have to find another functional solution. So otherwise, why would the neoliberal reform are sweeping away with welfare state? Because at one point, what was functional has now become dysfunctional because of changing profit motives. I don't think that that can be formulated on the same level of generality as such. Otherwise, we lose the criteria for. Otherwise, we fail to understand why neoliberal reform became at one point rational for capital rather than the mere caprice of Thatcher and Reagan and so on. I don't want to go on for too long, but this would be my 2 points.
Okay, I see. Okay, you gave a lot of points. I start with some early points you said, and if I will forget your last points, please remind me. The functionalism. I see. I was a little bit too lazy to exclude this. Because this would be an extreme simplification and very misleading, such an argument, because something is smoothly fitting to something, it must exist. No. When something exists, you have to give reasons for this existence. That it smoothly fits to something, okay, this can support that it stays, that it will not vanish at once, but you have to give reason. And this is in some respect a similar problem like Marx faced when he wrote Capital. He analyzed Capital. He also analyzed Capital in the seventh section of first volume as a self-reproductive system, that when you have this class difference between capitalists and workers, the same, what is the starting point of the capital relation is reproduced by the capitalist process. The worker gets the salary, comes out as the worker without property, the capitalist has reproduced his capital, comes out as the capitalist, and the process can start newly. From this you have to distinguish the first emergence of capitalism. It's a different process which Marx analyzes under the heading of primitive accumulation. In a similar respect, I think we have to treat also state theory on the one hand to explain the institutions and the mode of reproduction. This I try to hint by stressing the necessity of democracy, of public debate. And on the other hand, this I dismissed completely in this lecture, what you mentioned, the historical emergence. Now when we come to the forms of reproduction, then I stressed welfare state, for example, always is connected with costs. These costs lead to disputes. And so you have attacks on the welfare state, you have supporters of the welfare state. But this is the usual business. I cannot recognize what you said, that the welfare state threatens the profits. Okay, this is an accusation by conservatives or by certain capitalist groups. But, and maybe some will even believe this, mostly I think it is just a part of the battle, who has to bear the costs. Sometimes also it is a part of the battle, who can take the profits. When the health, the field of health services promises profits, then of course, there are a lot of capital groups who want to invest in this field and are interested that not the state will control this or the field of pension funds. When there is a situation where you cannot make profits with the health the health service, then also capitalists will argue, oh, this is a general task. No single enterprise can take this. We need the state in order to do this. So this battle is part of the usual business. And in this battle, there is the outcome which not necessarily, but mostly fits to the capitalist conditions. When it doesn't fit, then there is, someone has to pay the price, and you will have a very violently change. So, I hope it became clear that I didn't argue in a functionalist way, that I also tried to argue not in a pure structural, systemical way. Fights, class struggles, they have their function, but they have their function inside a certain structure. They are not the basis of everything. And my last point then is, when we want really to oppose to this capitalist system, then the extension of the welfare state is not the road to overcome the capitalist system. It is the road to fight inside the system, a fight which is necessary, like the fight for higher wages. But by a higher wage, we will also not overcome capitalism.
Do we have more questions or comments?
In reference to your last point, I remember a few years ago you written an article in Neues Deutschland about a sharp critique of the Linke. And I remember it was really, I was amazed reading it, not like, but I know that a lot of people would be interested in to hear your critique of the Linke, because some of the left here and in the region had actually some sympathies and look with sympathies to the development of this.
Yes, I also have some sympathies for Die Linke. It was not meant as a destroying critic, oh, go home, it's everything what you say is wrong. It was the time when Die Linke discussed a new, or we must say the first program, because it was a party who existed several years without a program, and they wished to have a broad discussion of this program, and so I was invited to contribute to this discussion. It was not me who I said, oh, I must now write something. I was invited from Neues Deutschland, and I thought, okay, when they invite me, they will have to bear the consequences. And I analyzed this program, which in the German left, or in parts of the German left, was seen, oh, it is really a left program, because it had some anti-capitalistic moments. There was even written a sentence like, we have to overcome capitalism. But when you looked closely, what do they mean by capitalism? Then it was really a bad thing. They had notions, there is the big capital, that is bad, and the small capital is not so bad. Big and small, with such a kind of distinctions, you totally miss the logic of capital, which is the same for big and small enterprises. And then they had the idea of democracy. Everything should be under democratic control, but no idea what this really means. When you have a public TV under democratic control, what does it mean? Do we have a referendum about a TV feature, or whatever is this? Or a banking sector under democratic control? So my critique was mainly that the concepts which they use about capital, about democracy, about state, are not very reflected, that they are very superficial, and this superficially is not a problem out of academic reasons. You have to have precise notions. It is a political problem that by this lack of precision of analysis, the political consequences are rather poor. And so I criticized this draft of the program rather sharply. It had not a big impact. They did this program with some changes. Perhaps it became even worse than the draft. So I didn't have any influence, but I didn't expect to have much influence in this program discussion. But I think it was important, and also in so far a good sign that they invited me to take part, because here I am a big fan of Rosa Luxemburg, who once wrote, "Each real step of the movement of the working class is much more important than 1,000 programs of the party." And so maybe a discussion about the program is more important than the final or the program itself.
Well, when you discuss the state in the Marxist circles, it's almost a matter of a good manner to mention the concept of imperialism. So just a brief question, how do you consider the explanatory potential of imperialism in today's international relations in contrast or in relation to how it was used through the 20th century since Lenin? After it, and maybe from the aspect of this necessity or non-necessity of these smooth democratic procedures concerning the relation between the, let's say, core and periphery in Europe, and the function of the European Commission in terms of usual, also from the bourgeois perspective, we criticize democratic deficit tendencies.
Okay, but, so the question is about imperialism today.
Well, do you consider that there's some explanatory potential in explaining the dynamics of global capitalism?
Yeah, okay. So first, I must say these classical concepts of imperialism, I'm very skeptical if they really explain something. There is a domination and rule in the international sphere. This is no question. But for example, especially in Lenin's imperialism theory, it is a very problematic theory, which he took not from Marx, he took it from Hobson, a bourgeois radical, and he took all the weak points of it. And I think it's as well in a theoretical way, also in empirical reason, this theory is cannot stand. For example, when Lenin argued in monopoly capitalism, there are not enough possibilities to make profit, therefore we have capital export in other countries, and these countries try to be controlled by the countries from which the capital export starts, and this gives a system of imperialism. Empirically, this totally break down, because, for example, before World War I, we had a lot of capital export, but not from Europe to Africa or Asia to colonies. We had capital export from one developed capitalist country to another capitalist country. And so the reason for capital export cannot be the lack of profitability. When in England capital is exported and there is really a lack of profitability, why then German capitalists export capital to England? So here I think we must be very, very cautious, and the old concepts I don't think have to tell us very much. They were wrong in their times and they are still wrong in our times. Nevertheless, we have expansion tendencies. On the one hand, economically, capitalism is not a resting system, it is an expanding system. Expanding in geographical dimensions, expanding in depths inside a society, that it goes deeper and deeper. And also, of course, it expands beyond political boundaries. On the other hand, we have an international state system which follows in some respects its own logic of power accumulation, because a state can act internationally only insofar it has international power. Sometimes the economic expansion and this logic of power goes in the same direction, but not necessarily. Not every international action of a state can be explained by economic interests. For example, whenever the United States intervene military somewhere, then very quickly someone tries to explain this because there is some oil, or nearby is an oil pipeline, and when there is neither oil nor oil pipeline, then they have the idea they plan an oil pipeline, or this. So there is always the attempt to find an immediate economic reason. And this, I think, is not at all the case. There is also a certain logic of political power. When we see, for example, as a very concrete case, the euro crisis and the behavior, for example, of the German government, who was or still is a main player in this crisis, in economical terms, it was a very risky policy that the German government, led by Angela Merkel, tried to impose on the rest of Europe an austerity policy which is economically very damaging. In the EU, I think 40% of the German exports are sent. What means austerity policy? It is, very generally speaking, a diminishing of demand also for the German exports. So, in a direct sense, for the German capitalist class, this policy is at least very risky, and Merkel also was criticized from this capitalist class. I think we can only understand it when we try to analyze the role of the German state inside the states of European Union and the role of the European Union in the worldwide competition of power centers. We have in the world European Union, United States, of course, rising powers like China and India. You can identify 5-6 power centers. In this new concert of power centers, Merkel's policy tried to strengthen the European Union following the German model. But if this is economically possible, I think is still an open question. Also, Merkel tried to secure the German position in the EU by this position, that there is a financial unity and a currency unity, the euro as a common currency, and the biggest benefits from this common currency has the German capitalist economy. But Merkel, having all these benefits, tries to avoid the costs of this common project, because nothing you can have without costs. So Merkel's policy, I think, is not to explain just by economic interests. You have to do a real political analysis, of course, also by using the economic facts and economic interests. But this reduction, what very often characterizes leftists' approaches, political action, why it happens, because it serves a certain economic interest, this is much too less to analyze the international sphere.
I have a big one, or something like apart from the simple reproduction.
Could you speak a little bit louder?
Apart from the reproduction of labor or employment, what other benefits do the workers have from sustaining or helping capitalism to go on? I don't actually see what could their benefits be, seeing that the basis of capitalism, as I get it, is making more profit. Profit is made by, of course, selling goods and making money, while reducing the cost of your labor force. So exactly how does it help the working class? And another thing connected to it, you mentioned several times non-capitalist societies or possibilities. I'm wondering exactly what are they? Do they exist, and does capitalism have a real present-day and functioning alternative?
Okay, the first question, benefits of the workers. Of course, there is a benefit compared with a worse situation. When capitalism, But this is for the daily life very important. When capitalism is flourishing, when capitalist economy, capitalist companies say, oh, we are searching for workers, and you are looking for a job, and you can choose between two or three offers, then you can negotiate. The capitalist offers you 1,000, and you say, I want 1,200, and you have a chance to get it. When the capitalist economy is in a crisis, you lose your job, and maybe you get 600 as unemployment support. So for the immediate daily life, a flourishing capitalism, also for the workers, is a better thing than a capitalism in crisis. And when you think of your daily life, and when you don't see a real alternative, that you can say, okay, tomorrow I go on strike, the day after I go on the barricades, and next week we have a total different system which works better. When you see this just as an utopia, as an illusion, then your alternatives are between the better and the worse capitalism, and then the better capitalism provides you some benefits. And this logic, it works, it really works, not only on this general level of flourishing capitalism or not, it works even in the competition of capitalist companies. That this is a situation very well known in Germany, that let us say the chief of a company says to the workers, we are in a very different, difficult situation, economic situation. Our competitors are very strong. I would like very much to pay you the high wages I paid all the time, but when I will continue this, then bankruptcy will follow. You all will lose your jobs. So please accept 5% less salary in order to strengthen our company, and when next year the situation it will be better, I will be happy to pay you 5% more. And in most cases the workers accept, because it has a real core, it's not just a fantasy. Your second question, non-capitalist societies. I'm a little bit modest, a little bit cautious with terms to use: socialist system, communist system, because we have a certain history of socialist and communist systems, especially in the Soviet Union and countries controlled by the Soviet Union, which had not very much to do.
That's exactly why I stressed present day societies. I mean,
yeah,
that actually exist and work today.
Yeah.
Just to say why I'm a little bit cautious, not such a stereotype starts, that I say socialism and people think, oh, he speaks of Soviet Union, which I don't see in any case as a kind of model. In present day, I must say, I don't see any real alternative. We see different capitalist systems, and these differences are not to neglect. I don't want to say, oh, capitalism is capitalism and is bullshit. It is a big difference, for example, if you have such a developed welfare state or if you don't have it. It is a big difference if you have a free press or if you have some dictatorial measures. For example, what now happens in Turkey, it's a big backlash for all leftist movements and attempts. So you have very different kinds of capitalism, different bourgeois states. But I don't see a real difference, a real alternative program. For example, many people saw in Venezuela a kind of alternative. But what happened in Venezuela by Chavez, I would say it was more close to introduce a kind of European welfare state than to introduce a real alternative to capitalism. And to have a European welfare state in Latin America would mean a progress, but a progress inside the different capitalist systems, not at all really an alternative. The problem with the alternative is we talked about this shortly also in the afternoon, that in a small country the possibilities for any alternatives are very, very limited. A socialist system of Croatia, I think it's not possible when all around we have capitalism. Maybe in such a big bloc like the European Union, you can speak of alternatives, of the possibility, the theoretical, economical possibility that such a big bloc can survive in a capitalist surrounding with a different system, but not a very small country. So you need really movements in order to reach this, which transcend the political boundaries. It cannot be a Croatian or a German movement. It should be a European movement. And we are far, far away from the existence of this movement. In so far, I must say, I don't see in the moment a working alternative. I not even see a big movement in favor of such an alternative, and this, I suppose, would be the next step. First, to convince people to create such a movement, and then we can talk about transition.
So I have a question also about functionalism in Marxism, but on the thinking about the concept of domestic labor, which is one of the core concepts in Marxist feminism. So it talks about the role of that labor in the production of labor power. And criticism is the so-called domestic labor debate of that. Of that attitude is that the domestic labor may be functional for capital because, of course, socializing the domestic labor would be of huge cost for capital, but it is not necessary for capitalism to function on this level of abstraction, let's say the highest level of abstraction, the level at which you held the lecture. So I'm interested in your opinion about this role of domestic labor. Could it be ever socialized in capitalism? Is it merely a cost for capital or something else?
This is a complicated question because the answer is it depends. It's not just a yes-no answer. It depends. In this domestic labor debate, at least in the elder lines of debate, it was often said that domestic labor is the foundation of exploitation, that the wages can only be so low because there is all this unpaid domestic labor, and in so far the domestic labor makes exploitation or exploitation in such a high degree possible. this basic argument, I think, is totally wrong. Because the socialization of domestic labor, what means to provide services which do the domestic labor, let us say childcare, preparing food and all these things, it has not only costs, it brings also benefits for the capitalist system. Why? In this traditional family where the woman is at home doing the domestic labor and the male husband going outside is exploited in the capitalist industry, by socializing the domestic labor would have the effect that for capital not only the husband is working but also the woman who was until now at home. So the capital would have two labor forces for exploitation. And this is a case Marx very shortly mentions in a footnote in chapter 13 in volume 1. Chapter 13 is about machinery and industry, and there he discusses also that more and more women are included in these traditional male industries. And what is his argument? He says, okay, when the women are included in the capitalist production process, they cannot do all the homework. So what before the women did unpaid, now it must be bought by the worker's family on the market. Therefore, the reproduction cost for the whole family is higher than before. But now there are two labor forces in order to earn this reproduction cost, and the value of the single labor force is diminished. Insofar, the non-socialized domestic labor is not automatically an advantage for capital. It can be a disadvantage when there is a shortage of labor force. Look, for example, the Scandinavian countries. In these countries, the socialization of domestic labor, childcare and so on, I think has the highest degree, at least in Western Europe. And they are flourishing capitalist countries. The rate of women employment is very high. So you have the socialization of domestic labor, and it fits perfectly to the capitalist development. In a situation of unemployment, of an overflow of labor power, then it's very nice to have domestic labor, to have the women not as unemployed persons, but as persons of who are in a reserve. So I would say domestic labor is more a kind of the English term of balancing the needs of capital. That in a situation there is an overflow of labor force, it's not necessary to socialize domestic labor. In a situation where there is a shortage, the domestic labor provides capital with an enormous reserve of labor power. Just organize the childcare, and a lot of women can be integrated in the capitalist production process.
Okay, our time is up. Thank you, Michael, for both lectures today. Thank all of you for attending, and watch out for our next manifestation within the next couple of months. So thank you.